Next up is Brian Sieben, and Brian is an adaptation planning specialist with the Climate Change Unit, part of GNWT's Department of ENR. Their recent Climate Change Strategic Framework provides tools and actions for adapting to the impacts of climate change in the NWT. To speak to this and more, welcome Brian.
So it's my pleasure to back up and tell you about the big picture this morning, some of the impacts that you're seeing in the Northwest Territories, and speak about some of the projected impacts and how we can adapt. So the overview, as I said, we're going to talk about the impacts that we're seeing now, future impacts, talk about adaptation measures, then talk about how the government of the Northwest Territories is dealing with climate change through the Climate Change Strategic Framework. Many of you may have saw this depressing statistic last month when the World Meteorological Organization released that we'd hit 403 parts per million CO2 concentration. So this is the big driver that we have to stop. And Jim's going to talk a bit more about this in the next presentation. In the Northwest Territories, we're warming faster than most other places on the planet. We're ground zero for climate change, which is makes my job really interesting, but it's really depressing. So if we look at this graph, this is air temperatures from the Inuvik Airport, average air temperatures from the 1950s when the station was established to present. And you can see that the rise is about 7 degrees per century. We only have about 60 years of record of Inuvik, so we have about 4 degrees of warming. But this is very significant, some of the most significant warming of the planet. And one of the things to think about is throughout the world, most warming that's been observed, if you take the average everywhere on the planet, it's now 1 degree. So in Inuvik, it's rising at a rate equivalent to 7 degrees over the same period, so much more. Let's compare the top of the Northwest Territories and the south of the Northwest Territories. So this is the Inuvik graph we were just looking at starting in the late 50s. And this is Hay River. The thing that you'll notice about these two graphs is the Inuvik graph at the bottom is much steeper. So it's warming much more the northern half of the Northwest Territories versus the southern half, 7 degrees versus 3 degrees. This is mean annual air temperature over the year. If we now look at winters, again, two graphs. This is Inuvik from the 1950s. This is Hay River. You'll see that the Inuvik graph is much steeper. So the slope is 12 degrees per century for January temperatures. And when you look at Hay River, 6. So almost twice the warming at the top of the Northwest Territories versus the south. But winters are warming twice as much as average air temperatures. And one of the things to point out here is when we talk about the Paris Agreement that was signed 2 years ago, where the world is trying to limit warming to 2 degrees, we already have 1 degree throughout the world. In the NWT, we already have blown way past that because of polar amplification. And even if we are able to meet Paris, we're going to have considerable more warming in the Northwest Territories. So the observed warming we've seen in the Northwest Territories is going to continue and double. So those of you from the Northwest Territories in the room are all experts and probably come up. We could talk all day about all the different climate change impacts. But some of the significant ones we think about are decreased ice coverage. This is a big one for winter roads, but also for indigenous people who rely on frozen ice for country food harvesting. Thawing permafrost, which was a big issue for all of you design professionals. Increased winter precipitation, another big issue that we'll talk about, has design implications. Changes in the habitat for critters, new species moving into the Northwest Territories. sea level rise. This is another design issue, and ocean acidification. Ocean acidification is a new emerging issue that doesn't get a lot of press so far, but it's really scary in that anything with a shell dissolves. And unfortunate, like polar amplification, because we have cold water in the Beaufort Sea, we are going to have the most severe ocean acidification. So this is a very concerning issue. Coastal erosion and river erosion, which is really amplified by permafrost thaw, making banks unstable. Drought and fires, and we'll talk about the summer of 2014, and changing hydrology. Many of you may have gone to the National Snow and Ice Data Center in the US. This is a site I really encourage you to look at. It has lots of really easy to use graphics, and they have great maps of the polar ice cap. Now here you can see a pink line from the polar ice cap. That's the median. So that's where it's showing over the satellite record, which is approximately since the 1970s, where the polar ice cap has been at the end of the season. The polar ice cap is at its minimum in the fall, and it's shrinking every year. It's shrinking at 9% in aerial cover per decade. But it isn't just shrinking in aerial extent, it's shrinking in thickness. So that very soon we'll get to the point that we don't have multi-year sea ice anymore, we just have winter ice that forms each winter. So that sea ice is a really important driver for what's going on up here. If you think about that really reflective sea ice, as it disappears, the dark ocean can absorb more solar radiation, which is a big factor that leads to polar amplification and why it's warming so fast up here. But in the past, at the Beaufort Sea, we had a very short ice-free season. Now we have a long ice-free season and a longer coastal erosion season. So there's a period where we can get more wind, more waves hitting this shoreline. But this shoreline is permafrost, ice-rich permafrost. Warm seawater hits it, and the coast literally drains away into the sea. And here is a picture of Tuktoyaktuk. Unfortunately, the poster child for climate change impacts, which can be significant impacts in the Northwest Territories. This is from 2016, a GNWT infrastructure building that had to be pulled inland. And this is what happens every year. It's the continuing story of Tuk as we lose the coastline. Again, on our Arctic coast in the Beaufort Sea, there's a little map showing where Pelly Island is. So Pelly Island is a little island in the Beaufort Sea where there's an Environment and Climate Change Canada weather station here. And there's these big cliffs that are ice-rich permafrost. And you can see where they've mapped the coast erosion over 4 years. So over 4 years, almost 110 meters. Watch where that white weather station is. So our Arctic coast has considerable change. So this impacts infrastructure. We talked about the Tuktoyaktuk, but it also impacts living things. So here's a plant called the hairy brea, lives on Cape Bathurst. Looking at remote sensing imagery, we know that on average, we're losing 10 meters a year, every year due to coastal erosion. And this plant likes to live along these cliffs. It's the only place it's found in the world. So this, you always hear about polar bears in the World Wildlife Federation. This is the poster child of climate change in the Northwest Territories, and it's the first species that we've had to deal with as a government. We have a species, it's a species at risk, and we developed a recovery strategy for this species. And one of the strategies, sadly, is taking this plant down south to live in greenhouses at universities. So mention that decreasing sea ice, we're also decreasing lake ice and river ice, and we depend a lot on winter roads in the Northwest Territories. So we have shorter winter road seasons. Here's a picture from Yellowknife Bay that maybe you may remember from a year ago when a snowplow fell through. This sort of story happens every year along the Mackenzie Valley winter road. Permafrost thaw is another giant issue. Ed's going to talk more at length about permafrost thaw after lunch. This is the Inuvik runway, a dip that formed overnight a couple of years ago. giant issue for the government of the Northwest Territories. Permafrost thaw and infrastructure is a big cost. Some of you may have saw Sarah Brown's talk at the Geoscience Forum last week, where she gave a dollar sign for public infrastructure in the Northwest Territories due to permafrost thaw of $1.3 billion before the end of the century. So one of the things, it's getting warmer in the Northwest Territories. What does that mean? As it gets warmer, we're getting more wet, heavy snow. More of shoulder seasons where it can snow. We have lots of buildings that were designed with older building codes that didn't consider the new snow loads. So many of you will have seen this picture or heard the story of Samuel Hearn School in Inuvik, which had this foyer collapse, and luckily no one was injured. But this led to a whole series of new codes and standards to deal with snow loads. So permafrost thaw on the landscape is also a really big issue. And my colleague Steve Kakela, NWT Geologic Survey, works on this. And when permafrost thaws on a hill, you get a thaw slump, essentially a landslide. This picture made the front page of all the newspapers in Canada a year and a half ago. Talked about a lake falling off over a cliff. So what happened here is we had a thaw slump on this hill. But what it did is it undercut this lake. So the Northwest Territories government put out a public safety warning to stay out of this valley, not a good place to go hiking. And shortly after this picture was taken, there was catastrophic lake drainage, like a dam bursting. This causes huge impacts on turbidity downstream. In the southern Northwest Territories, again, if we talk about the landscape level, so most of the Northwest Territories is covered in permafrost, but the southern Northwest Territories, it's discontinuous permafrost. And here near Fort Simpson, Wilfrid Laurier University has been studying the permafrost at this site. And you can see that on your spruce mounds, there's these ice lenses. Over time, these ice lenses are decreasing as it gets warmer. And using air photos, looking at this site historically, we can tell that over the last 60 years, 40% of the discontinuous permafrost has disappeared from the site. Very scary. What does that mean that's happening to the trees? Is the trees are essentially drowning. So this is converting from boreal forest to bog, or from caribou habitat to moose habitat. All the plumbing and hydrology is changing. Lots of significant change. This is a picture I think that Jim may have taken a couple years ago in 2014. Those of you who may remember in 2014 was the most significant drought year for the Northwest Territories ever. The government of the Northwest Territories spent $100 million putting out forest fires. It was our most severe forest fire season ever. Putting out forest fires and dealing with evacuations of communities and the impacts on hydroelectricity. Those of you from Yellowknife will remember that the hydroelectric facility that supplies Yellowknife with hydroelectric essentially ran dry. And we had day after day of smoke. When we think about smoke, one of the things that design professionals like yourselves have to think of in the future is, can you design an HVAC system that will remove smoke? In 2014 at Stanton Hospital here in Yellowknife, operations had to be canceled because there was so much smoke in the operating rooms. Another emerging issue for winter roads is that it can be minus 40, but there's water flowing. So how is that happening? So groundwater under pressure is emerging on these winter roads and forming icings, which makes them really unsafe to cross, and these are increasing. One of the things we're finding with, as the permafrost thaws, there's increased mobility of groundwater. So groundwater is rapidly changing in the Northwest Territories as permafrost thaws and is no longer immobile to groundwater. So here's a map of the Northwest Territories, and we often talk about critters moving north. They think we'll move up from BC or Alberta to the Northwest Territories. So on this map, here's the Mackenzie River, and this is looking at Pacific salmon coming to the Northwest Territories. So as the graduate student Karen DeMaul working with Department of Fisheries and Oceans Canada, has a community-based monitoring program where she has a reward in communities, has a picture of what a specific salmon species look like, and gives a cash reward if you find a specific salmon. So these Pacific salmon are swimming up around Alaska and coming down the Mackenzie River in increasing numbers every year. So the question, and one of the things, do you think about this with climate change? Yes, this is an invasive species, probably bad news for our existing cold water species, but it might be an opportunity as well. This might be a future fishery. So what are some of the future impacts? So we have huge impacts already, but for as far as future impacts, much greater winter temperatures, up to 12 degrees warmer, more foundation damage due to a permafrost thaw, rise in sea levels by the end of the century, more forest fires, increased permafrost thaw and movement of forests. And I'll quickly just talk to you a bit about movement of forests. So on this map, this is a series of four maps. Up in the top left, if you view this as now, and this sort of line between the pink and the purple here, that's roughly the tree line. And look at the Southern Northwest Territories Alberta border here, that's boreal forest. If we fast forward to the end of the century, you see this brown show up here. We had to look, what is brown? So these are mapping ecosystems that's represented by climate. We don't have that in the Northwest Territories. We had to figure out, what is that brown? The closest thing we could find, that's Southern Saskatchewan, Estevan, Saskatchewan, losing boreal forest. It's going to be too dry in the Southern Northwest Territorials to support boreal forest. And you can see in this bottom graph, for all the mainland Northwest Territories, potential to grow trees by the end of the century. So I'm going to show you some climate projections that have been taken from global climate models down to really fine scale by the University of Alaska for us. And this is looking at winter temperatures. So again, let's look at the top panel, which is now. This is showing what typically what December temperatures look like in the Northwest Territories. And if you look at this, the scale here on the legend, we're seeing minus 20s and 30s getting colder as we go to the high Arctic islands. So that's what we expect the Northwest Territories to be like now. Fast forward, 2095, we are seeing significant warming in the Northwest Territories, but draw your attention to the high Arctic islands, where here we were minus 27, minus 31. Here, like around minus 10, like 20 degree warming potential was modeled. So that's with the current emission scenario that we're unfortunately on, this something called RCP 8.5. So significant warming. This also has significant impacts when you think about future sea ice. For those of you interested in designing a building, we have generated climate change projections for all the Northwest Territories communities or for mine sites. You can get these easily if you go to the ENR climate change website, nwtclimatechange.ca, and there's a link to the University of Alaska site here where you can also go. So here we pulled up a histogram showing temperatures modeled for Inuvik in the future by month. So if we look at 1961 to 1990, that's an historical average, or as climatologists say, a normal, 30-year normal. And if we look in winter, we can see that historically Inuvik is minus 28.6. This is showing at the end of the century, 2099, this dark crimson color is going to minus 16.3, again, a 12 degree warming. So it's interesting to looking at the curves. I showed you at the start the observed record, looking over our shoulder what's happening in the past, significant warming observed in Inuvik. Going forward, expecting, again, very significant warming going forward. And again, I encourage you to look at this site if you need to look at projections for any NWT community. Sea level rise for our four communities has been modeled by the Geologic Survey to be at least a meter by the end of the century. Potentially an additional 60 centimeters, based depending on what happens in Antarctica. But this is just at the end of the century. We're committed to at least another meter past this, even if we meet the Paris Agreement. So significant warm sea level rise is ahead. So what do I do today? We work on climate change adaptation. So what actions can you take to try to reduce the negative impacts of climate change or take advantage of new opportunities? Well, one of the things that we can do are engineering solutions, which design professionals like yourself can do. And a great example is in Tuktoyaktuk, where the government reinforced the shoreline to try to buy us some time with riprap. Think about engineering solutions. They work, really expensive. Most of you know the government of the Northwest Territories seasonally builds a winter road up the Mackenzie Valley. To make that road more resilient, the ice crossings were replaced with permanent bridges, because the bridges, the ice crossings would warm soonest, closing the road. So by putting permanent bridges, you can extend the season. And as you all know, last week the government also put an all-season road into Tuck, and will be putting an all-season road into the Tlecho over the next few years. There's also new codes and standards. The Standards Council of Canada developed something called the Northern Infrastructure Standardization Initiative. And Ed Hove in this room was highly involved. A Northern technical expert really contributed significantly to the development of these standards. So the existing standards included thermosiphons, permafrost degradation on buildings, snow loads. And that snow loads standard was really a result of what happened in Inuvik, but to that standard, drainage and geotechnical site investigations and permafrost. So this is from the, were developed over the past 5 years. There's a new set of Northern Infrastructure Standardization initiatives coming out. One of them that this group will want to follow is there's going to be a new standard from the north for fire resistant building materials. Thinking about what happened in Fort McMurray, how to make buildings in the Northwest Territories more resistant to forest fires. Other things that we can do, and we've been working on, is coming up with a course for communities, how to consider climate change. The GNWT has something called the School of Community Government, that people can learn about best practices for climate change communities. We also have come up with summaries of adaptation projects. We have these on the table at the registration desk if you're interested. We have them from all three territories. If you're interested in learning some ideas that may be useful. One of the things I do encourage you to take a look at is this Homeowner's Guide to Permafrost. Again, we have some copies on the registration table. Craig Scott did a lot of the work on this, and Ed Hove contributed to this as well, so thanks, Ed. This is really great. Is that a lot of the tools we develop for design professionals, engineers, government decision makers. This is one of the things that we develop for ordinary people to think about how do you can you maintain the permafrost under your house with preventative maintenance. So I encourage you to take a look at that. Similarly, fire is a big issue. We're expecting increasing fire with climate change. Fire smart is something that we need to be doing in the Northwest Territories, and the government is supporting significantly. We have a series of plain language guides for homeowners, how to make their properties more fire resistant, or removing brush, needles, cleaning out the gutters, etc. The three territories work together on climate change. We have similar issues, such as thawing permafrost. One of the tools, I've told you that nwtclimatechange.ca is a place you can find some tools for decision making. Another place you can look is northernadaptation.ca. This is a website the three territorial governments jointly have for joint initiatives. One of the things you will find there, we jointly held a permafrost workshop a few years ago in this very place. We have 36 videos on permafrost, so if you ever can't sleep one night, you can watch permafrost for 3 days. Risk and vulnerability assessments are a really good thing to do to figure out where you need to take action to deal with climate change. I'm going to talk about community wildfire protection plans. We've also done this for mountain pine beetle. Some of you may have heard that BC was kind enough to share the mountain pine beetle outbreak, and mountain pine beetles survived, which they weren't supposed to be able to in the Northwest Territories. So our Forest Management Division of ENR went in and had to remove those mountain pine beetles. You can do it, vulnerability assessments for buildings, and you can map permafrost thaw in communities. Briefly talk about a building vulnerability tool. This is a tool that the GNWT is developing to assess the vulnerability of government-owned buildings. So essentially, you look at the snow loading and permafrost and triage which ones are most of a concern. Which ones do you have to have structural engineers and geotechnical folks spend a lot of time looking at and prioritize for maintenance. Again, shout out to Ed, and he contributed to the permafrost portion of this tool. Another site that may be worth looking at, our Municipal Community Affairs Department has something called a Hazard Identification and Risk Analysis Tool. This is looking for emergency management. How could climate change impact all the hazards in the Northwest Territories? This is done for every region of the Northwest Territories if you're interested. For infrastructure, for the folks in this room that are designing things, there's a really useful tool called PIVC, developed by Engineers Canada with federal government money, the Public Infrastructure Engineering Vulnerability Committee. I encourage you to go to this website. The GNWT has been an early adopter using this in the Northwest Territories. So hazard mapping. We can retrofit buildings or roads or coastlines to try to deal with climate change impacts, but it's a lot easier to build things in the first place that will be less impacted by climate change. One of the tools the Northwest Territories government developed are community wildfire protection plans. These are all on the ENR website. This is a map of Delaunay. This is showing fire hazard, basically mapping the fields, what can burn. Gives a guide where you can build a fire guard. Will also be useful in the future with, and will interact with that new standard talking about fire resistant building materials, where if you're building a stretcher, what you may want. One of the more really exciting useful tools is mapping the active layer of permafrost. So Ed will tell you more about permafrost after launch, but the part of the permafrost, the active layer that seasonally thaws, can be seen by the Canadian RadarSat satellite that can see movement of a millimeter of the ground surface as it thaws. Here's a map of Yellowknife, again, that's available on our website. You can zoom in and find individual buildings. Mapping that movement. Blue isn't moving. Yellow and red are moving a lot, so you can see the Yellowknife Airport's got some grief. Edge of Old Town over by the Racquet Club. School Draw, sort of the places you expect if you've seen permafrost damage. So this is a tool, if you're going to build something new, you can look at as a first cut to think, where could I have to spend a lot more money on design to think if I'm going to build? So if you build on blue, less of a concern. We are revising this, and we'll have super high resolution maps available in the next 6 months for most NWT communities. We initially started targeting a few communities and are now targeting every community in the Northwest Territories. A shout out to my colleague Colin Avey in the Center for Geomatics in the Northwest Territories. So we now have terabytes of data, and we've also been mapping the Inuvik attack road, so we'll be able to actually monitor how that road is changing as well with permafrost. So if you're interested in these maps, watch our website, and they'll be available for every community very shortly. A lot of the hazard mapping I showed you was for infrastructure, but it's really neat to think that we can do it for cultural resources as well. So I mentioned thaw slumps, those permafrost landslides. So yes, they're a huge problem if you think about the Dempster Highway causing landslides, but they really impact archaeological sites as well. So this is an interesting project done by the Prince of Wales Northern Heritage Center, where they took a map of predicted occurrence of thaw slumps in cultural sites and overlaid it to find out what's more vulnerable. What the most vulnerable sites where you may have to rescue archaeological sites. I'm going to mention Steve Kakel, our GNWT permafrost scientist. Some of you may be aware of, who does a lot of work mapping these thaw slumps. One of the projects I encourage you to watch going forward is he's leading a project to develop a ground temperature database for the Northwest Territories. So all ground temperature data will be in one place for the Northwest Territories, both in the landscape, watching thermistors going down the Mackenzie Valley, seeing how the permafrost is warming, but also under buildings. So new government buildings in the Northwest Territories have thermistors installed under the building, so we can monitor the temperature before there's a problem and know if we have to take action. So one of the things we need to do with climate change is more monitoring. So both under infrastructure such as buildings and roads, pipelines, But we also need more monitoring climate stations in the landscape. We have a fraction of the number of climate stations, the stream gauges, tide stations in the Northwest Territories we need. And we need more research. We are very fortunate that we have Wilfrid Laurier University partnering with the Governor of the Northwest Territories to undertake climate change research, but we need considerable research to inform decision making. And we need your help. So there's something called LEO, the Local Environmental Observer. This is an app. I encourage you today to download this app. It's available for Android and iPhone. It's free. It's called LEO Reporter. Citizen Science Initiative, where ordinary people in the Northwest Territories can observe climate change and tell us about it. I'm not going to know about all the things going on about climate change in an office building in Yellowknife. We need people out in the communities and indigenous people out in the land who are seeing climate change impacts every day can really help with LEO because they're the experts on climate change observations. But we want everyone to download this app. So whether you're seeing a new critter you've never seen or whether it's an infrastructure failure, culvert overflowing, we want to hear about it. So we'd like all of you to help. So we're really eager if you could download anything, download this app and send us in a picture with this app of anything out of the ordinary. You can also do it using the LEO Network website. Now I want to talk a bit about the big picture as far as the policy side. So I mentioned that 2 years ago, the Paris Agreement, where the nations of the world committed to limit climate warming to 2 degrees with aspirations to try to have it at 1.5 degrees to prevent damage to island states. With the new Canadian federal government, there's something called the Pan-Canadian Framework, which is essentially the national climate change strategy for Canada that was agreed to by the federal government and premiers. And then provinces and the federal government are taking action. We have the new climate change strategic framework, which I'll talk about in a minute, that will be released likely next week. So the climate change strategic framework was developed by the government of the Northwest Territories following a year of public consultation to communities. I mentioned that we have a partnership with the other two territories. And there is also a new Northern Adaptation Strategy that will not include not just the other two territories, but Northern Quebec and Labrador. So the current Legislative Assembly made the Climate Change Strategic Framework a priority. And it's to determine the NWT's contribution to Canada's efforts to address climate change. Essentially, one of the big things that it's going to do is set what is our greenhouse gas target and better prepare the NWT to adapt to climate change. And a big part of that is we need more monitoring and knowledge. There's three pillars for the climate change strategic framework: knowledge, adaptation, and the low carbon economy. So the low carbon economy, that is how can we use less fossil fuel? So what's our target? Jim's going to talk to you, Jim Sparling, my former manager, is going to tell you a lot about lots of really innovative ways that we can reduce energy through energy use through renewable energy. After me, one of the things to point out is to the government's reorganization, my department, Environment and Natural Resources, sets the overall target for greenhouse gas emissions, and our colleagues in the GNWT Infrastructure Department are developing an energy strategy which use that target, and they operationalize how that will be done within the energy sector. So if there's a target set, they will figure out how much renewable energy and which projects are needed to make that target happen. We need to increase our knowledge so we have the information to adapt, and we need to adapt to changes. And this is a really expensive challenge. And one of the things to think about, I mentioned that Sarah Brown from the Association of Communities said it's $1.3 billion to adapt infrastructure. One of the big challenges on the landscape level, you can't really adapt. And for people that are dependent on those country foods and critters, it's very challenging times ahead. If you have any questions, I encourage you to ask some questions now, but feel welcome to contact me. As I said, our climate change strategy will be posted on the ENR website likely next week, so you'll have a chance to provide comment there as well. And we expect that to be tabled in the legislature this spring. Thank you very much.